Are you interested in ham or handheld radio, but just can't seem to find out the right information you need to get started? Well, I am, and despite thousands of videos on YouTube reviewing and talking about the subject, very few seem to consider a new audience and address their needs. In this video, we will cover the basic functions, popular terms, how to pick up the right radio for you, mistakes to avoid, and we'll finish it up with my recommendation for the best pick. Let's go! Amateur radio or ham radio is an amazing hobby to have. It's fulfilling, it brings back a glimpse from the past, very handy at certain situations, and more importantly, it's cheap. At least compared to something like photography, with one lens costing upwards of 2 grand in some cases. This video is made to help you get started, and is what I would have wanted someone to tell me when getting started. Abundance of information is fantastic, but just like handling a smartphone with rich features, it can be frustrating to navigate through all the options. So, the intention here is to simplify it. This should also serve as a reference video for future videos I intend on publishing on ham radios. Quick disclaimer before we start. I'm not a professional. I just enjoy tinkering with gadgets and doing research and getting them to work. In other words, a nerd. The stuff we're going to discuss today is not a blanket statement that applies to every single radio. Some will have features that others don't, but in general, they all have shared features which we will be talking about in today's video. Let's start with bands. Bands or band is basically a way to refer to frequency number that a particular set of people or industries uses. This is to ensure that bands are divided fairly and operating them without conflictions or jams. To help understand the frequency line, we're going to be using this graph. This is the entire frequency line. The commercial radio we're all familiar with, which is from 88 to 108 megahertz, is here. Air band from 108 to 136 megahertz is here. Marine band is here. Amateur band is here. And so on. Each band is reserved for a certain industry or activity. Most modern handheld radios cover all these bands. Stick around to the end of the video where I will show you my recommendation which covers all of them. Some handheld radios are able to not only receive but also transmit signal, which is why I opted to start with this segment. Depending on your country, you might require a license to carry a radio that's capable of transmitting signals, as it can disrupt businesses.
This is your captain speaking. Can I order the chicken sandwich, please?
This is a reenactment for comedic purposes. In some cases, it's banned altogether. If you are in Germany, Switzerland, Poland, or South Africa, make sure you read your local laws before even attempting to buy one. You might also encounter terms such as dual or tri-band. A radio can be catalogued as a dual band when it allows operation on two separate frequency bands. For survivalists and people who want to have a survival kit prepared in the back of their car, it's ideal to have both options available in a single piece of equipment. Although this is handy, it's not super necessary when you're getting started. And the last part I want to discuss about while we're on the subject of bands is the 70 centimeters and the 2 meter bands. They are simply a portion of the frequency band. This usually indicates the range of the signal. If you want to transmit the signal farther, it's better to use the 2 meter band, as it's where you will find most ham radio users, which is usually between 144 MHz to 148 MHz, and can travel as much as 100 miles or 160 kilometers. But you might be required to use additional equipment such as repeaters to cover larger distances. How to use it? It's simple. Using the amateur band, punch in the same number on two different devices, and use the push to talk button to start using. Listen for some time to ensure the frequency is not in use. Make sure you find what is the amateur band in your country, as it can vary. For example, in the United States, amateur bands are from 144 to 148 MHz and from 430 to 450 MHz. In Europe, it's similar, but it can slightly change depending on your country.
Now, this is what it looks like from the factory. I have not changed any settings whatsoever. So, the way you're going to see me operating it is as if you're doing it for the first time.
Welcome. Frequency mode.
All right, so we'll start with this one here. Now you'll see two different numbers. You can use this button here, the one that says AB, to switch between the two of them. It doesn't matter which number you're going to punch in, or it doesn't matter where you're going to punch in the number, in the A or B. So, we're going to pick a number.
4, 6, 7, 0, 0, 0.
So this is the number I picked. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the second device and pick the same number, punch in the same number.
4, 5, 4, 6, 7, 0, 0, 0.
Now that's it. Now I've entered the same number on both. All you have to do is just now press. You'll see it transmits. Now usually, let me just lower the volume, show you how it works. So now it's at its lowest. When you press, you will see the green light turn on. You'll see the green light here turns on. That means it's receiving, and you will see an orange light from here, from this device here. So when I press the button, it's orange and it's green there.
Most radios will have channels to store frequencies, so you can program them for quicker use, instead of punching in the numbers every time you want to use it. Now let's say you want to do something different. For example, listening in on the weather channel. A quick Google search will help you do that. Using the United States as an example, there are dedicated websites that will have frequencies published depending on your state, where you can get the weather channels and other important signals. I will leave a link in the description for some of the most popular websites. Now let's talk about range. Most handheld radios can pick up signals and transmit with a radius of about 6 miles or 9.5 kilometers. This distance can vary depending on how much the handheld radio power output is, which is measured in watts. This number can easily be found while shopping for a radio. They are usually anywhere from 5 to 10 watts, with some advertised at 14.5 watts, like the one I have here. 6 miles sounds fantastic to me. The truth is, however, is most of these radios do not reach these distances, and although advertised as 5 to 10 kilometers, that's usually under ideal conditions with no obstacles. You can expect to get about 1 to 3 miles on average. You can, however, extend the range of the coverage using something called repeater, which is not something we will be covering today. To put it simply, it's a device that can be placed in a strategic location to help extend your signal and pick up remote signals, effectively extending the range of your radio. Chirp. As mentioned earlier, Chirp is an open source free to use software on both Mac and Windows, and supports a huge variety of radio brands and models. Besides being able to upload batches of frequencies, you can do something cooler. You can upload or change the firmware. This will enable you to use the firmware that can display frequency waterfall or frequency graph, which is incredibly handy to scan for a signal quickly and efficiently. There are other similar softwares like RT Systems, but Chirp by far is the most popular. Tips and tricks. When both people press the transmit signal at the same time, neither one will be able to hear the other. Hence why you see in movies and law enforcement the use of the words over to indicate the end of a sentence, and Roger to indicate understanding. It's a way to let the other person know that you have finished talking and streamline the conversation. It's very easy to talk over each other and miss parts of the conversation. What caught my attention with ham radios is the ability to capture random signals such as aviation signals. It just seemed fascinating at the time. However, over a period of time, I found out that marine signals are far more interesting than air signals. Air signals get boring very quickly as they sound robotic and they use a lot of abbreviations that you wouldn't understand if you haven't worked in aviation before.
Firing off commands to pilots.
Delta 393 Atlantic ground, runway 27 right, taxi via Lima, hold short of taxi via Dixie.
And it makes sense also since they have limited time to communicate.
Summoner 105, reduce speed to 210 knots. Quality 671, reduce speed to 210 knots.
Marine, however, is far more relaxed and the conversations are easier to understand.
1, 5, 6, 6, 7, 5.
In the amateur band, no frequency is reserved for a particular person. It's open for everyone to use. Anyone can use any frequency. But it's common practice not to use a signal that someone else is using so that everyone can enjoy this hobby. Buying process. Now that you know what you look for in a radio, let's cover the buying process. The buying process is simple and cheap, with most handheld radios ranging from $40 to $100, with some as cheap as $20. Some of the most popular brands are Quansheng, Yaesu, Zaston, and Baofeng. The latter is responsible for popularizing this hobby with its infamous UV-5R that launched at a price of about $40 back in 2012. You can find most of these brands on Amazon.com, but since I use Chinese handheld radios, which offers the best bang for buck, I buy them from AliExpress. If you're buying multiple devices, just be careful not to buy the same accessories over and over again. For example, you only need one programming cable to program most radios, so you don't need to include it in every purchase. I would also recommend a radio with USB-C charging, as the docking stations some radios come with are bulky and outdated. You might need to buy at least two handheld devices to be able to have a two-way communication, but you don't need to stick to the same brand, meaning you can have two handheld radios from different brands and they can still communicate with one another just fine. Popular terms. There's quite a lot, but we will just cover a few, just for basic understanding. RX, which usually stands for receiver. This is to indicate that the device is able to receive a signal. TX, which usually stands for transmitter or transmitting device. This usually indicates that the device is able to transmit a signal. High frequency or HF. High frequency is a range of frequency between 3 to 30 MHz on the radio wave spectrum. HF radio is ideal for communicating long distances. VHF, or very high frequency, is the range of frequency between 30 to 300 MHz on the radio wave spectrum and is ideal for outdoor environments where a line of sight between each device is not obstructed. UHF, or ultra-high frequency, is the range of frequency between 300 to 3000 MHz or 3 GHz on the radio wave spectrum and is ideal for communicating indoors, as the UHF transmissions penetrate obstacles more effectively. Squelch, which if you understand the literal meaning of the word, you'll know what it does. It basically just mutes the background noise when there's nothing playing. Accessories. Some of these accessories can be necessary depending on what you want to use it for. There are a ton to choose from. As an example, if you are a trucker and will be listening to signals all day long, you will need a battery eliminator, which keeps your device on all the time without worrying about batteries. This is just an example out of many, like extended battery, antennas, antenna adapters, card holders, wireless programmers, and so on. Battery life. This wouldn't be a random tech video if I don't speak about battery life. Generally speaking, most batteries last an entire day, sometimes days depending on your use. But if you have it switched on all the time, it's effectively scanning for signals, which means it will last you just under a day in my experience. No big deal though, as you can buy batteries separately and they generally last a lot longer compared to smartphones, as they don't have to power up a huge OLED screen. My recommendation. When you're new to something, usually you want to go for the best the technology has to offer. Although this is a good strategy in most cases, there can be some drawbacks. For example, this one here has all the bells and whistles, including a colored screen, which sounds good on paper. However, on a sunny day and under direct sunlight, it's very difficult to see what's on the screen. Not to mention that you'll probably be wearing sunglasses. This might sound like I'm nitpicking, but believe me, it's very annoying to deal with and downright impractical sometimes. What about the range? Why not pick the one with the most range? Well, although mostly advertised as 10 and 14 watts sometimes, most of these devices output 3 to 8 watts instead. I'm not claiming they're false advertising, but these numbers are probably produced under ideal conditions. So without waffling, my overall pick is the Quansheng UV-K5 8. It has a black and orange screen, which is fairly easy to see under the sun. The range is adequate with about 5 watts advertised output, and it's one of the cheapest handheld radios and also one of the best in terms of sound quality. It's also supported by Chirp and can be programmed to have a frequency graph. I will leave a link in the description if you wish to buy one. Now, if I can leave you with one advice, is that don't be intimidated by it. It's much, much easier than the video might make it seem. If you can operate a smartphone, you can definitely operate a handheld radio. So there you have it. A brief summary and an introduction to the handheld radio world. If I missed something, feel free to ask me in the comments section. Or if you're an expert on the subject and want to chime in, you're always welcome to provide your feedback. If you enjoyed this style of voiceover videos, consider checking my playlist for similar videos. And if you lasted this long, thank you so much for watching, and I'll catch you in the next video.